So now let's come to the things that is written in it says in Matthew. I need to read some passages. Luke chapter 2 verse 9. Luke chapter 2 verse 9, we see that, and the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone upon them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy. It was a joy for all the people. It is for all the people. Matthew chapter 2 verse 13 onwards. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in the dream and said, departed means the wise men. When the wise men departed, the angel of the Lord appeared to them, Joseph, in a dream and said, rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there till I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him. So just after the wise people left them, they were fleeing to Egypt. Why they were fleeing to Egypt? Because it has got a theological or, you know, some kind of explanation. Matthew says that Jesus is coming. Of course, he was born in Bethlehem, but he is coming to Nazareth. He is coming back to his hometown from Egypt. Why? Because it is exactly the same thing happened to the people of Israel. So the Bible explains the New Testament people as new Israel, right? We are new Israel. So God was doing something to make similarity with the emerging of the original Israel, that is the people of Israel in the Old Testament, and he was making or turning things in such a way that some kind of similarity is happening in the life of the new Israel. So earlier the Israel was the son, and in Exodus chapter 4 verse 22, Exodus chapter 4 verse 22, God says, and you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my firstborn. And I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. So Israel is called as the son of God, the son, the firstborn. And now Israel is not the son, it is Jesus Christ. Mark chapter 1, verse 1. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Okay? So in the Old Testament, who was the Son? Israel. In the New Testament, who is the Son? Jesus. So God wanted both of them coming out of Egypt. It is true that Jacob and his sons were going from Canaan or Palestine to Egypt and coming back from Egypt. Likewise, now Jesus is staying in Palestine, and from Palestine he is going back to Egypt, and he is coming back from Egypt. In chapter 2 verse 21 to 23 we see, Matthew chapter 2 verse 21 and 22 and 3. But when he heard that Archelaus reigned over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there, and being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. So they were returning. Verse 19. But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, rise, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead. And when they reached in Palestine, they came to know that it is the son of Herod is reigning there. So then they were leaving to Nazareth, because it is written in the Old Testament that the Messiah will be coming out of Nazareth. He will be called as a Nazarene. And Jesus is called as a Nazarene. So all these things were happening, and this was designed by our God. The old Israel, the son of God, they were in Palestine because Abraham and his son Isaac and his son Jacob, they were staying in Palestine. And from there, they went to Egypt and they stayed there for 400 years. And they came back from Egypt. Now, Jesus, he was born in Palestine and he is going to Egypt, and then he is coming back, and finally he is not just in Israel, he is coming back to Nazareth so that he would be called a Nazarene. It is a new Exodus. It is a new Exodus. So it is through the old Israel in Old Testament the blessings of the Lord was coming through, and now it is the Son, Jesus Christ. In the Old Testament, if somebody wanted to be blessed, they needed to see that they are embracing the King of Israel. In Psalms 2, we read that if you want not to be destroyed, you need to kiss the Son. The Son. It is asked by God to kiss the Son. That Son is the King of Israel. Now, who is the King of Israel, or who is the real Son? It is Jesus Christ. Okay? So it is a new Exodus. Exactly what was happening in the Old Testament. You know, God is making everything in such a way that it is happening in the same way in the life of the new Israel. Who is the beginning of the new Israel? It is Jesus Christ. Okay. Now let's go. Let's see that there was a massacre of the infants in Jerusalem, right? In Matthew chapter 2, verse 16 to 18, we see that then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, was in furious rage and sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years of old or under, according to them, the time which he had ascertained from the wise men. So there was a great massacre of all the infants. But remember, exactly this happened at the time of Moses. So before the Exodus, the same thing happened in the life of Moses. In we see at the time of Moses, Pharaoh was killing all the young children, right? All the children of Israel. Now Herod is doing the same. I was trying to find the similarities of the old Exodus and the new Exodus. And now we come to the point, we come to see the life of John the Baptist, who is the forerunner. Okay? A lot of things to learn about the life of John the Baptist, but as we do not have much time, I'm not going deep into it. But I will tell the Bible passages so that you can understand it very fast later. It is written in Mark chapter 1, verse 1 to 8, and Matthew chapter 3, verse 1 to 12. Mark chapter 1, verse 1 to 8, and Matthew chapter 3, verse 1 to 12, and John chapter 1, verse 19 to 34. John chapter 1, verse 19 to 34. We'll go through that passage very fast. So we see God has appointed and anointed a person to introduce his son. That's why we are calling him a forerunner. He is supposed to introduce his son. Of course, suppose my daughter is studying music, and if she is performing her art for the first time before the public, I will ask somebody to introduce her. So I will ask somebody who is good in music, who can introduce my child, right? So the best person available, I will try to ask that person, bring that person to introduce my child as a singer. But who was chosen by God to introduce his son? God chose a man, not what we expect. He was choosing not the Caesar or the emperor of Rome to introduce his son to the world. Not even he was asking Herod, the king of the Jewish people, to introduce his son. Not even he was asking a high priest to introduce his son to the public. He was asking a person called John to introduce his son to the people. And John, he was not a celebrity. He was not a person of our expectation. He was not with a royal robe. He was a person with something like a small piece of robe, a mantle. It was he was not with an executive suit, or he was not with a royal robe. He was a simple person, a person who was living in the wilderness, and even he was not a person with of great knowledge and all. We do not know. He was, God chose this person as a person to introduce as a forerunner to his son. So this is what I say. The way of God is much different than our ways. Many times, John may not be able to enter into a church with this trust, I think. He was a crowd puller, of course. People in Matthew chapter 3 verse 5, we see that people from Jerusalem and all Judea and all region round about Jerusalem, they were all coming to hear the voice or the message of John. And multitude went to him. And why? Why he came? I don't think it is because he was a person who could impress the higher community of the people. No, I don't think so. If he was in this land, in India or in America or some other place, I don't think he will get a chance to speak in any of the crusades. Or even in a church pulpit. I don't think people will call him to a church pulpit. Because his dress itself, it is with camel hair and things like that. You know, it's very odd to see a person like him in a church. But God chose him. We do not know God who is in great in the eyes of God. Once a cowboy was going to a church in US. And you know the cowboys, normally they don't change the dress. They use a jeans and a hat and a dress and smells bad many times. And he was sitting in the back. And all the people who were sitting in the back went to the front. Never they were going to the front. But now because this cowboy was sitting in the back seat, all the people who were sitting in the back seat, they went to the front. And they were all looking at him in a very odd way. And they never wanted him to enter into the church, even the pastor. With their look, they were looking cruelly at him. One of my friends said that, sarcastically he said, Saju, in our church we have enough people, and if any other people are coming, we need to see that they are keeping our standard. Otherwise we don't need to see that more people are coming to the church. If the people are coming with BMW and all, it's okay. Otherwise we don't care. We never want to see that they are entering into our church. But we cannot say don't come. So what we do is fleeing him with a dirty look. We will flee him with a dirty look. I'm quite sure all these people were trying to flee him with a dirty look, but this Jim, this cowboy, he was not looking at those people. He was just enjoying the presence of the Lord and sitting there. And after the service, pastor came to Jim and said, Jim, I've seen that you're coming to the church. It's okay, but if you come next week, if you come next week, you understand? That means, you know, we don't want you to come next week. If you come next week, before you come, just ask Jesus, Jesus, if I go to this church, what kind of dress I should wear? So Jim said, yes, All these people thought he would never come again. But the next week he was there with the same dress, using it for another week. And pastor was coming to him and asked him, Jim, last week I asked you to consult Jesus what kind of dress you should wear when you come to this church. Yes. Yes, pastor. Did you ask Jesus? Yes. Then what Jesus said? And Jesus said, and this Jim said, Jesus told me, son, I do not know about your about their dress code because I have never been there. I don't know about the dress code of that church because I have never been there. Many of the time, you know, I'm sure God is, you know, God can come only the places where poor Jim can come. You get my point? God is coming to only the places where this poor Jim can come. We need to understand that. So John was a crowd puller. But it is not because of his dress or because of his affluence or not because of his big sound system. People were coming to him. Few years back, Hillsong came here, right? And that time I was taking classes to a youth group in Bombay, and a young guy came and asking all these youth to come to the Hillsong meetings. And you know why and how he was asking people to come? He said, guys, Hillsong is coming. You know that, right? We are using the best audio system in Asia, okay? Everybody should come. Guys, you should come to hear Hillsongs. We are using the best audio system in Asia. We are using the best audio system in Asia. So everybody should come. You understand what I say? These are the things that we project in these days. The technology that we use. The smoke machines. Not like this. The smoke machines. We have smoke machines and all. In Isaiah chapter 6, we see that there was smoke when the seraphim were singing and worshiping the Lord. But as there is no seraphim, no angels in our meeting, we are producing smoke. I'm so sorry for it. I'm so sorry for it. These are all pretensions. What we need is the Holy Spirit. I'm not against good singing and all. I like it. But do not pretend. Do not act. Do not try to become somebody else. This is the biggest problem that we face in these days. Do not try to become like somebody else. In one meeting, not now, 5 years back, once I was telling, I do not want to become like Benny Hinn. In those days, everybody wanted to become like Benny Hinn. Now, nobody wants to become like him, but earlier it was not the case. Everybody wanted to become like Benny Hinn. So people were asking, why? Why you don't want to become like Benny Hinn? I said, even if I try to become like Benny Hinn, I cannot become like Benny Hinn. Oh, that's the reason. So if you could, you wanted to become like him. No, I don't want. Why? Because I cannot become like him and I do not want to become like him. Why? Because I cannot become like him. Oh, okay. That's the case. Then I said, no, it is not just the thing. As I cannot become like Benny Hinn, even if Benny Hinn turns upside down and stand, he cannot become like Saju. Saju cannot become like Benny Hinn, but Benny Hinn can never become like Saju. That is also there. Yeah, I am Saju. He cannot become like me. You get me, my friends? God has only one Benny Hinn and God has only one Saju. There is one machine God doesn't have. One machine God doesn't have. You know what it is? It is a photocopy machine. God doesn't have a photocopy machine. He makes everything original. You are superb. You are original. You are unique. There is nobody like you in the world. So try to become like you. God wants you to become like you. God wants you. Never try to become like somebody else. Don't try to sing like Hillsongs. Try to sing like you. Don't try to preach like Billy Graham. Preach like you. Because you are unique. You are unique. John was not a pretender. He was unique. He was not trying to become a crowd puller, but he became a crowd puller. Why? It is not because he was using a special kind of language, nothing like that. People were attracted to him because he had a message. In Luke chapter 3, verse 2, we see there that in the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. The word of the Lord came to Zechariah. You get me? The word. You know, in Old Testament, we have seen in many places the word came to Ezekiel, the word came to the prophets. In Ezekiel chapter 12, verse 1, 17, 21, 24, and 13, verse 1. If you go through that, everywhere you see that the word came to Ezekiel. And it is 400 years the people of Israel were failing to hear a word from God. It is after Malachi, you know what happens? There was no prophet who got a word from the Lord. All the scribes of Israel, they were all interpreting the scriptures. The scribes did not have the word from the Lord, but they were interpreting the scriptures. But now a man is coming with the word of the Lord. It is after 400 years. And that's the main reason why people were after him. I tell you, my friends, if you have a message, then certainly people will be after you. If you pretend, and if you are reproducing somebody else's words, if you have many quotations, some people have many quotations. They quote this man's, quoting words. I'm not against that, but you cannot see that people are after you if you are quoting other people. The problem, if you are quoting other people, people will think, then why should I go after him? Instead of, why can't I go to the original person? So try to be original. Get a message from the Lord. Then certainly people will be after you. And he was not a reed shaken in the wind. He was a man sent by God. In John chapter 1 verse 6. In John chapter 1 verse 6. In John chapter 1 verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Sent by God. We need to see that we are sent by God. We need to have that kind of anointing. Go to the people only God sent you. God will send you. If you are going on your own, you cannot have people. Many times, you know what happens? I want to become a preacher. I want to become a missionary. It's good. It is, if you have a liking for that, it is good. But you cannot go as a missionary unless God sent you. You understand my point? You cannot become a preacher unless God anoint you as a preacher. Maybe you want to become a preacher. That is only the beginning. If you want to become a preacher, God will certainly make you a preacher. I have no doubt about it. But make sure that you have that anointing. Make sure that you have heard the word of God. Make sure that you have a word for the people. And again, we see that he was not a reed shaken in the wind. A man with self-realization. He knew what he was. When people were coming to him, even we see that the priests were sending people to him and asking him who he is. He was not saying anything extraordinary. They were asking, "Are you Christ?" He was not saying, do you think that, I don't know exactly, maybe I am Christ. Did he say like that? No. He knew who he was. He said, "I am not Christ, I am just a voice. I'm just a voice. He was happy to hide himself, the real person. The problem with us, many times we are not ready to become a voice for the Lord. We want to project ourselves. But what is needed is a hidden ministry, seeing that we are just a voice of God. I was with celebrant singers for some time when they came to India, and I liked that the leader, it was in 1976, I think, 1976. And the leader of that group, once he said something like this, I'm just giving another version. Take the case of a banana. And banana has an outer skin, you know that. And what do? When you peel it off, the outer skin, do you eat it and you are throwing the banana? No. What do? You take the banana and throw the outer skin. He said, we are like the outer skin of a banana. He said about the coconut, but I'm telling about banana because it is more, anybody can understand it. The outer skin of a coconut, outer skin of a banana, it doesn't have anything to do, just to cover the original thing. We are like the outer skin of Jesus. When it is peeled off, people need to get Jesus. And let's have the mind that let people throw us away. Why we are worrying about having an identity or things of for ourselves? Why we want to become somebody? It is always needed to see that we are just a voice. A voice. Let's close our eyes. Hallelujah. Lord, many times we are projecting ourselves and showing that we are somebody. Many times we proclaim the world that we are making big sacrifice. But we know that the sacrifice you made on the cross, when we look at the cross, nothing we are doing for you is a sacrifice. Lord, many times we are not people of self-realization. We think we are this and that. But let's be like John. He was not trying to become like somebody else. We understand that we are unique. We never want to become like somebody else, oh God. We don't want to preach like somebody else. We don't want to sing like somebody else. Help us to see that we are becoming exactly what you want us to become. Also, Lord, help us to see that we are just standing as a voice, just as a voice. And we are giving you to others. Let's be like the outer skin of a banana, oh Lord. We just want to cover you. And when we go before people, we just want to be peeled off and thrown away so that people will get only Jesus. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.